B4 came out of closed session at 7:05. On item number one, the board gave direction to our labor negotiator, and on item number two, the board heard from our fire chief about a potential employee hiring. All right, any, I'm jumping down to item D, anything on the agenda?
No.
Move to the up.
Oh, sorry.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. All right, consent calendar, draft minutes of regular meeting for September 13th, and the bills. I have a motion.
Just.
Oh.
Go ahead.
Yeah, so I move to approve.
All right, second?
Second.
Comments from the board?
I'm just wondering on the second payroll, the overtime, it kind of jumped again.
$7,000, number 320, or is it?
No, it went. No.
$357.
Yeah.
Yeah, well.
Same old.
Down two people.
Any other questions or comments?
Some of that is reimbursable for one of the injuries. From the work-related injury, we get some of that salary back, so.
I have a question on the minutes. Did Director Shea abstain from voting on new other business items two and three? I recall he abstained on item one.
Do you remember?
I don't think I abstained.
You abstained?
New and other business?
Items two and three.
So he made the motion on the.
Correct.
I can change it.
Okay, I don't believe he did abstain.
I believe the only thing he abstained.
Was the first one, who was number one.
Good catch.
Yeah.
Any other questions, comments?
On the payments, item 287, SDRMA adjustment, we paid the annual amount of $139,000 in July. What is this adjustment for?
This is a reconciliation of 15-16. Basically, all amounts paid upfront are estimated based on budgeted payroll, and then when payroll is finalized at the end of the year, it gets reconciled and adjusted. Sometimes it's a credit, but usually it's always a not credit.
Otherwise known as a debit?
Yes, I'm just trying to make very clear here that it is, we spent more on payroll than budgeted, so that's where it comes from. That's a big, long, complex series of formulas, how it kind of gets to that, as far as allocations go and everything else.
We lease our copy machine?
We do.
And so we get two charges every month, one's the lease, and what's the other, maintenance? What is it?
The one is for inland, it's maintenance, and although it's probably not through inland, it's maintenance as well as the printing, charge for printing.
Oh, okay. I see, so there's a counter and they.
Correct. We get X number as part of our lease, and anything above and beyond that, and well, it always goes above and beyond that, because the X number is fairly low, it's pretty standard. I actually worked with this exact same company at a previous job before I got here. They're the same guys, they're one of the bigger players.
Okay. Thank you, no further questions.
Any other board questions, comments? Any comments from the public on the consent calendar?
I wanted to make a comment on the minutes, the draft minutes from last month. And this is no criticism at all, okay? I know that minutes are extremely difficult to write, and there's not really any rules to follow, but there was a comment about Barnello commented she is happy Mr. Kai has stepped down. And that was only the first half of my sentence, and I think to be fair and balanced, the second half of my sentence should be put in as well. And the second half of my sentence said, and I certainly hope the next board will be a little bit more reasonable. Just to be fair and balanced.
Thank you for that.
And then I do have one other thing. Mr. Shea, were you asking again about overtime for the fire department?
Yes.
Okay. And this is only an observation, but every single month you ask about overtime. And I was just going to suggest that either you attend a fire commission meeting, or you read the minutes from the fire commission meetings, or you email the chief, because it's just repetitive, and it's always the same, we're down people, we're down people, we're down people.
Just like to put it out there, because it's higher than normal.
I just wanted to make that comment.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Any other comments? Steven?
Couple things. First of all, thank you for bringing up the expense issues, and particularly about the payroll. It's, you know, I've been attending a lot of these meetings, and it hasn't escaped my attention that we've expanded our payroll considerably through additional staff. And at some point, there's got to be some adherence to budget. I mean, you can't just push the limits of the budget all the time. So that's item number one. Item number two, last month there was discussion about the maintenance shed and hiring an architect or employing an architect, and I heard that, and I was just surprised that any such consideration would happen. Maybe there's a reason that I don't know, but if you look, I would recommend you do the following. Go to other maintenance yards, see what they have for facilities, and I think you can get a lot of good ideas. They're all using basically pre-built structures. This is not high architecture here. We're just building a structure to keep materials and equipment dry. So anyhow, those are the two comments.
Thank you. I'm going to call a question. All of those in favor of approving the consent calendar?
Aye.
All right. Item F, public comment, open time for items not on the agenda. Any comments? Linda?
Thanks. This is about the board responding to criticism on Nextdoor or other social media. Back in March, the board had a lengthy discussion about the bylaws and social media posts, and the district manager said he's very cautious about it, doesn't think it's regular practices for government agencies to be engaging on Nextdoor. Leah said, leave the bylaws as they are. It's okay if it's in there, but not fully clarified. And we just said, it's in there, it was not to do it, not to, for the board members not to post on Nextdoor. Mr. Shea said there's really only a lot of nonsense on Nextdoor. Ms. Perry said board members should not be on social media acting as board members, and the district manager agreed with Isabella's comments. And Mr. Naylor said it's 10 o'clock and wants to move on. So it was agreed to leave the bylaws as they are, where the directors are not allowed to comment on social media. Then the very next month, you were going to be approving the draft bylaws. Didn't say anything about revising, just approve the draft bylaws. But then Mr. Kai said he wanted to add just a small suggestion. And his suggestion was, I would like to change directors are not allowed to comment to directors are discouraged from commenting on any issues within district subject matter jurisdiction on any social media. And it appears that Mr. Kai kind of slipped this in at the last minute. The agenda said nothing about making revisions, it only said approve. And there was no discussion and there was no comment allowed from the public. And every single one of you four people, board members, let it go. So my comment is, the next time that you're considering changing bylaws, I would think it would be a good idea to come back to this particular issue so that you can have a discussion again, because to me, it doesn't make sense that 1 month you would all be against it, and then the next month, Mr. Kai would slip it in, and not one of you said one word. about him slipping it in when the agenda did not say anything about making revisions. So that's my comment. Thank you.
Thank you. Stephen?
This has actually been said before, but there is a problem here with this board and First Amendment rights. Yes, we've got three people in attendance. I don't know who you are at this time. I write letters. I speak up, and the letters don't get published, and the comments do not get recorded. And this will probably not get recorded. I hope it does, Carolyn. But in absence of that, you can do a couple of things. You can start videotaping programs. It doesn't cost a lot. And you can adhere to the standards set forth by other agencies in Marin and throughout the state of California. Thank you.
Thank you. All righty. Moving on to item G, district matters. We have an update from the ad hoc committee to address district unfunded future liabilities, and we have a presentation today. So, Matt, who wants to lead this?
Well, I'll make some preparatory comments. Again, from the last meeting, we pretty much wrapped up our analysis of the actuarial reports on both pension liability and the OPEB liability. And in order to put ourselves on a firm footing of understanding what we could do in terms of reserves, we also thought it was prudent to investigate capital reserve issues and forecast capital reserves. And we have continued to work on that in the past month. And we now have about 75%, 80% of that work done, and we have a reasonable estimate of capital reserves, certainly from the fire function, also from Park and Rec, realizing that many of the expenditures, capital or otherwise, are covered by Measure A. So we've got that data down. There will be further discussions to fine-tune that, make sure that we're in good shape, but next month, I think we will be able to publish how much we will be reserving on an annual basis for capital, or we intend to reserve, as well as OPEB. And we, of course, already know that pensions are somewhat etched in stone. We pay those every year. So that'll be the next month, and we have our second presentation.
Okay. So now, would you like to invite Mr. Gross up for the presentation, or?
Yes.
Thank you. I appreciate it very much. What I've done is it okay if I position myself here? So in the middle, I just brought a folder for each of you. I know that in the agenda package, there's the slides, and Eric did a lot of work to get us to where we are, so I wanted to thank Eric as well. We just wanted to bring you some color slides and let you know that I'll try to be as brief as possible, but also informative, because you're making a decision that will hopefully benefit you for many decades to come. I appreciate prefacing everything, Director Naylor, with the fact that the goal of the district is to reduce unfunded liabilities. And quite frankly, for the last 9 years, I've been blessed with a really good job at CalPERS. One that's a lot less polarizing and volatile than representing the pension fund, because with other post-employment liabilities, pre-funding is completely voluntary. So you made a comment about the fact that these contributions are set in stone, and that's kind of the problem that CalPERS faces politically often, is they have to do the right things on behalf of the members to ensure that those benefits are going to be paid out in the future. And oftentimes that means delivering the bad news to employers, and in specific particularity, the impact of the bad news to their budgets. This is kind of a good thing, where if you start to do things right now that are a bit of a sacrifice, fiscally speaking, you'll actually benefit in the future. And by doing this, more prudent fiscal behavior, you're actually going to save money, and there will be a crossover point that you'll experience. It, usually it's somewhere between 12 and 15 years, but let's just call it 15 to be more conservative. We're actually fully funding your annual required contribution as determined by an actuary is cheaper than just paying the bills to keep your lights on, which is what you're currently doing. So things actually get a lot easier, and then the benefits are quite numerous. So I'm just going to walk you through this slide deck as quick as I can. Please interrupt me and ask questions at any time. My goal is for you to know what you need to know to make an informed decision, and that's it. One of the things about our program that makes my life very easy is that we're not for profit. That means I'm not on commission. I do not make a dime if you decide to do this or if you decide not to do this. That said, I've done the analysis, I've spoken to Eric and Director Shea and some other people at the agency, and based on the information you provided me, it makes a whole lot of financial sense, okay? So the impact of pre-funding has been shared with you before. That's slide number 2 at the bottom of page 1. There's 3 main benefits you're going to take from this. The first benefit's pretty simple, you're going to see rather immediately. Your actuary is going to be able to rely upon an actual assumption that investment income is going to be larger than what you're getting where your current budget dollars sit. County Treasury laid for money market the last 10 years, less than 1%. You're going to generate more than that from our investment vehicles over the long term. The sacrifice of that benefit is that you'll receive more volatility. So in any given year, you can lose some money, whereas with County Treasury, it's very unlikely that you're going to lose any money. But over the long term, that higher investment return assumption, which actually is called discount rate, is going to reduce your liabilities. So you're going to benefit from that in the financial reporting realm. And that is going to speak to your ability to, again, and we're on slide 2, I'm talking about the second bullet now, demonstrate prudent financial management. Because the liabilities that you report on your financial statements are the direct result of the relationship between the assets you have dedicated irrevocably in a trust fund account like ours and the liabilities themselves. So you can't really change the liabilities, and if you want to do that, that's a separate conversation. It's related to benefit offering, and you can do that, and it's like I said, separate. So what you're trying to do with our trust fund is one piece of that solution is increase the pool of assets irrevocably dedicated to offset those liabilities. And one of the things you do right off the bat, like I said, just to kind of reiterate that is if you reduce the liabilities from the get-go by using different discount rates, you're starting with a lower ceiling or a lower goal. Okay. Finally, over the long term, because of the compounding interest that you'll generate from these investment vehicles as opposed to county treasury laid for money market, you're going to generate a lot more investment income on top of your investment principal, as opposed to just continuing down the path that you're on right now, which is just paying your bills or paying as you go, using money from your current year operating budget to keep the retiree benefits active. And so that's really, it's a funding policy in and of itself, but it's one that is probably not as effective long-term as the funding policy that we're proposing. So what I want to do now is jump to slide number 3 at the top of page 2. Let's just say that we all agree that pre-funding is a good idea. It's demonstrating prudent financial management. It will help you with your bond rating. It will help you lower liabilities, and it will allow you to save money over the long term. Then why would you want to do this with the program that's in place at CalPERS, which we call the CERP, C-E-R-B-T. It stands for the California Employers Retiree Benefit Trust. There's 5 main reasons. They're very simple. One is that you delegate the investment fiduciary responsibility directly to an expert, which in this case is the CalPERS Board of Administration. We set the investment policy, meaning you don't have to make decisions about which asset classes to invest in, what is the weighting relationship between those asset classes, when do we buy, when do we sell, when do we rebalance. You simply say, you handle all of that. We'll tell you which of the 3 menu items that we want to put our money into at the time, and we reserve the right to change that menu option at any time in the future. Most agencies that I've talked to over the last 9 years, at least 85-90% of them, they want to delegate. It's very rare that an agency wants to manage that themselves. And so that's an offering that's a benefit to you should you choose to move forward with us. The next thing is that the reality is that you're juggling all kinds of things. You're wearing many hats all the time. We have to provide a simple program from a procedure, a policy, an administrative perspective, because you might think about OPEB once a month. or twice a year. And so it can't be complicated. It can't be something that is difficult for you to interface with. So we've designed a program that's very simple and straightforward. We have forms that are easy to complete. One example of that is the contracting process. If you decide to approve staff's recommendation to join the trust fund, it just requires 6 documents, and once we get those, we can turn and approve the contract within 1 to 3 business days. So it's very simple and straightforward, and then you retain that same administrative kind of approach to simplicity as you continue to participate in the trust fund. One of the other things that we do, and there's 3 remaining, is that we offer a trust fund that's 100% Governmental Accounting Standards Board compliant. So it's in your vested interest to comply with GASB 43, 45, 57, and the new OPEB accounting standards that you'll be faced with in June 30th of 2017 and 18, which are GASB 74 and 75. We offer that to you. So you don't have to worry about whether or not the things that we're kind of sharing with you with respect to education and information and consultative services are going to help you comply. You can confirm with your external auditor that in fact that they will. And in 9 full fiscal years of trust fund operation, we have yet to have a single audit finding, having been audited by our external auditor, MGO, in each of those years. So I think we're on the same page. We have a shared vested interest in GASB compliance. The next thing is that we offer excellent customer service. And I want to just go on record right now. This is a public meeting. We're being videotaped and audio recorded. CalPERS leaves a little bit of room to be desired in some of their program areas with respect to customer service. I can't deny that. They're 2,800 employees. It's like a large battleship. It's a large bureaucracy. It's not always easy to pivot and be nimble. We have a trust fund that is made up of 13 full-time employees, 2 part-time. We've been in operation for 10 years. We have a good system in place. We're very nimble. We can offer a level of service that I think and hope with respect to my relationship with all of you, I can guarantee will not only meet but exceed your expectations. One example of that is I'm here tonight, and I'll continue to be here for you as you need it. So I think you'll be very happy with the service. You already have my direct desk phone, cell phone, and email address. And on the final slide of the slide deck, you have that contact information for all of the major players in our program that you would need to get in contact with. So I can promise you that we will deliver excellent customer service. I hope that you will agree over time. And then we do all of this for the absolute lowest cost. Most of the trust fund providers out there are going to charge you at least 0.5 percentage point or 50 plus basis points. We're doing everything, all-inclusive, admin, custodial services, internal and external investment management, currently for 10 basis points of assets under management. We've never been lower than 2 or higher than 15 in any given year. And that's how we charge. We're getting excellent cash flows into the program. I find it highly unlikely that over the next 10 years we would ever even get close to exceeding 20 basis points in our costs. To put that in perspective, for my 401k to supplement my CalPERS pension, I'm paying about 35 to 40 basis points just to do that. For scholarship accounts for my 2 children, David and Caitlin, paying around the same. So this is a fantastic deal. And a smaller agency, medium-sized agency like Marinwood CSD, you're being subsidized by a number of the other participating agencies, including 24 agencies in the county of Marin and the county of Marin. So that's a great subsidy because they're keeping your costs really low, and that means that the amount of money that you keep in your pocket and retain for future usage is higher. Okay, so those are the advantages of the program. There's not a single OPEB trust fund provider in California that I'm not aware of. None of them can offer those 5 advantages concurrently. They can do 3 in many cases, sometimes 4 of those advantages, but concurrently all 5, it's not close. That probably also explains why we have 497 employers participating over the course of the last 9 to 10 years, and our competitors have no more than about 150 to 175, and those are the largest ones. So we're doing really well from a competitive perspective. So I think this is a really good choice for you.
It's strictly related to California, right?
But, yeah, okay. Correct. Yeah, Eric, good point. We're only in California. Some of our competitors are also in other states. None of them have 500 like we do in all of the states in aggregate, but they are in some other states, primarily Texas, Maine, Massachusetts right now, Rhode Island as well. If you go to the next slide, slide number 4, I want to talk real quickly about how we're different than the pension fund, because CalPERS is well known for its pension fund, and quite frankly, not that well known for this. And there's a lot of confusion about transferring over attributes of the pension fund and applying them to our program that I want to alleviate concerns about, because I think it's a valid position to have about having concerns about entering into a contractual relationship with CalPERS if it's like the pension fund. One example of that is they retain the right to increase your employer rate of contribution. So I'm going to start with that. Contributions in this trust fund are not required ever, not as an initial contribution amount, not as an annual minimum contribution amount. There are no fees to leave us if you decide to terminate your contract and transfer assets to another trust fund, so you literally never have to send us a dime. In fact, we have 5% of employers in the trust fund that to date have not sent in a penny. Now, many of those just joined recently and just haven't made a contribution yet because they're budgeting for it in the next fiscal year. But there's a handful, 5 to 10, who just haven't, you know, had the budgetary capacity to send us money, and that's okay, they haven't been charged a dime. So you reserve the right to make a contribution if and when you want, to the tune of however much you want, and you can vary contributions on an annual basis based on budgetary factors that are inevitable. Okay. The next bullet on this slide, again, slide 4 on page 2, is you choose the investment vehicle. So that's different than the pension fund, where you're stuck at 7.5% as the discount rate, whether you're fully funded, super funded, underfunded by 20%, whether you agree with the investment philosophy of obtaining a result of 7.5% annualized or not. Here you can choose between three asset allocation strategies. You can move your money at any time. I'm going to actually give you an illustration in just a moment of what those menu options look exactly like, so you can kind of see what you're selecting between. The next thing is that you use outside independent consulting actuaries. Very different than the pension fund at CalPERS, where there's an office internally at CalPERS, the actuarial office, which based on actuarial assumptions and policies can dictate liability outcomes, and that's the goal that you're pre-funding towards. So it's really something to be concerned about. In this case, you alleviate all concerns because you hire an outside independent consulting actuary. So what you limit yourself to is staying within the parameters of the actuarial standards of practice and then also adhering to governmental accounting standards. What does that mean for you? It means you retain greater flexibility. The downside of an outside independent consulting actuary, we don't offer these services even if you wish for them to exist at this point in time, is that you probably spend a little bit more money. I mean, I think CalPERS being not-for-profit could do it for less money. But I would actually, if in your chair, as opposed to my chair tonight, I would actually prefer to pay more and retain the control because it can lead to better fiscal outcomes on your financial statements because of that. And then finally, you can reimburse yourself from the trust fund. You can reverse the flow of cash by ceasing to make, contributions and seeking reimbursements. So you would actually be liquidating money, and that just is not possible from the pension fund. So as you can see, this is a very different product. So I would just ask you respectfully to evaluate it on its uniqueness as opposed to considering it to be identical to the pension fund, which it just is not. We have a totally different investment policy. The funds in, or the assets in our trust fund are not pooled with the pension fund assets. We invest totally differently. Okay. Next slide on page 3 at the top, slide number 5, is a menu of our options. You can see we have three asset allocation strategies. The only difference is their 20-year median expected rates of investment return and their risk profiles. Most employers are in strategy 1. 355 of our 497 are there. That's because they have significant OPEB liabilities and insignificant assets. So they want the highest discount rate to grow, so they're like a 25-year-old investor, right? And then secondly, that higher discount rate reduces liabilities, provides them with lower liabilities that they're booking on the balance sheets of their financial statements, and that's another desire of theirs. So that's what explains why that's the case right now. What we do see is employers become more well-funded, and when they do, they look at the more conservative strategies because their primary goal, which was growth, now shifts to preservation of existing assets in the trust fund. Makes a lot of sense, okay? So we're seeing that trend, but we're very young. You know, we're only 9 to 10 years old. So most of them are still choosing strategy one because of its attractive benefit set that comes along with it. If you look at the slide underneath that, you can see that we invest in the same 5 public market asset classes. No exotic investments here, very straightforward. You have global equity, fixed income instruments, global real estate investment trust funds, TIPS or treasury inflation protected securities, and commodities. And the only difference between strategies 1, 2, and 3 is the level of participation. So if you start with strategy 1, for example, you move to strategy 3 over the course of a 20-year period, you're not driving all of a sudden a Honda Accord when prior you were driving a Ferrari. It's the same general concept. It's all within the Honda family. You're just driving a slightly different vehicle, one that's more conservative. So that makes a lot of sense because you're not changing your general investment philosophy. If you look at the second column on that slide six at the bottom of page three, you'll see that three of our asset classes are managed passively, two are managed actively. All of them are measured to, with respect to performance, to public objective benchmarks that are very common in the investment industry. So the reason I say that, and I use the term public market securities, is I want you to feel really comfortable about the degree of volatility with these investments. It's very normal. It's very standard. In fact, we invest less aggressively than the CalPERS pension fund. They also invest in private equity, buying and selling individual buildings or larger, you know, real estate holdings that they have to value on an annual basis in the effort to make a profit over a period of time. We don't do that. So we have a less risky portfolio in general because of that. We also, though, have a slightly higher equity, global equity in this case, allocation, because we have to make up a little bit of investment return that we're not getting from that type of investment. So it's just an example of one of our differences. If I move to the next slide on page number four, I wanted to show you our investment results through September 30th. So very recent, and Eric was very cordial and allowed me to update this slide because as of about 5 days ago, I didn't have this data yet. We wait for a report from our investments office to get this, but I wanted you to see the most relevant information. And I was going to do this whether the results were higher or lower, but they're actually higher and quite significantly. For example, our five-year number in strategy one is currently 9.42% with a benchmark of 9.14. Last month, as of August 31st, that number was 7.88%. And I wanted to point that out because I'm not here to promise you that from 1 month to the next or quarter to the next or a year to the next, we're going to, you know, deliver positive returns. I mean, I've been in this trust fund long enough to see years where we've had negative returns and years where we've had positive. But the aggregate, when annualized over 5 years, is 9.42. Over inception to date, which is about 9 years, 4.13. Both of those numbers absolutely blow away what you were getting in county treasury late for money market. So by staying as pay as you go, you're just simply leaving money on the table. Now, long-term, a 4.13 inception to date is not what you want, and you're going to want to see something better than that. But you have to remember that in 07 and 08, we were exposed to market conditions that were an anomaly so significant some people call it a crash. So, I mean, that's going to weigh us down there for a while, but if you look at strategies 2 and 3, their ITD numbers are 8.02 and 6.11 respectively because they lop off that. They actually came into reality after that was market conditions. Strategy 2 was born in October of 2011, Strategy 3 in January of 2012. So these are all indicators that this is a significantly higher yielding investment opportunity, regardless of what you pick in county treasury. It just makes a whole lot of fiscal sense. What you're picking up is volatility that you weren't exposed to before, but OPEB is a long-term benefit paid out in small increments over many decades. It's not as if you're ever gonna need the money all at once in one lump sum. So it just makes a whole lot of sense to invest it in this way. If you were investing on behalf of a tech company for a year and you needed cash flows 12 months from now, a different boat, but this isn't that boat. So these investment results indicate that it's a pretty good investment policy that thus far has worked out really well, despite the fact that we've been in an entire window of time, those full 9 years of significant market volatility. And unfortunately, we started the trust fund at a pretty difficult time. One of the things that doesn't jump off the page here, and then I'll move to the next slide on costs and kind of wrap things up for you, is the fact that there are 19 data points here. And every single one not only meets but exceeds its performance benchmark. So what that's telling you is two things, is that our hybrid style of investment management, which includes some passive and some active management, is exceeding benchmark, which it should do, because when you introduce active management, you should exceed benchmark. But our costs are really low. Because our competitors, quite frankly, have earned very similar returns over the entire period of time. I haven't seen much deviation, as much as we try to tell each, our customers how different we are than each other. They really haven't been that different, but they miss their benchmarks about 80% of the time. So when you look into why they're doing that, it's because their returns are reported net of the fund manager fees, and only net of that, and those fund manager fees are so significant that they're missing the benchmarks because of that. And they have Cadillac funds, really good funds that you would want to have, like our investments also, but they're just paying a high premium to have that. We're taking advantage of economies of scale using State Street Global Advisors as our external investment manager. So does the pension fund. So I mean, we're getting a pretty good deal on this, and we're sharing that deal with all of you who participate. Let's go ahead and go to the next cost slide. I just wanted to reiterate, we're 10 basis points of assets under management. I wanted you to feel more comfortable about the most important piece of the cost structure is that it's reliability. So when we started off, we were real small. We tried to anticipate how much money we would get in the first year net of disbursements. We anticipated $350 million. We actually got $550 million. So we had four employees at the time. Our total fee rate was 2 basis points, 2/100ths of 1%. So that's pretty absurd. You're not going to hold on to something like that forever. We knew it was going to go away. The only question was how much. We went to 6 basis points the next year, then 9, then 12, then 12 again, then 15. So I started to look at this and I said, you know, a valid question that I'm going to get in the field is, are you going to be the typical government program that keeps going up and then closes the door and charges the people who are stuck inside the room to maintain the cost? And that's not what happened. Actually, over the next 2 years of business operation, we reduced that from 15 down to 10 because the cash flows were so healthy. So we're at a point now with cash flows about to increase from about net $600 million annually to about $1.2 billion over the course of the next decade. And that's based on projections coming solely from the state of California, who are increasing their cash flows on an annual basis through memorandums of understanding and via cost-sharing agreements. So this is actually going to happen. I think our fee rate is only in jeopardy of going down or retaining its close stability over the course of the next decade. So it's a really good deal for a long time. And if fees ever go up, you can always just move to another competitor, who, by the way, are about 5 times more expensive anyways. It's kind of a moot point. We're really dominating that cost category. The next slide at the top of page 5 just reiterates something I've already said, so I'm going to choose to skip that because I'm kind of being verbose here tonight. I apologize. Let's go to slide 10 at the bottom of page 5. Just wanted to let you know that there are other community services districts in the trust fund. We have 14 of them right now. And then within Marin County, if we flip the page and we go to slide number 11, there are 24 agencies. I've listed those for you so you can see exactly which agencies in the county of Marin are participating in the trust fund and investing money with us. And then I've also then, as a courtesy on slide 12, listed the community services districts throughout the state of California who are doing this as well. So you might recognize some that are closer to you or that you know from prior experience. I just wanted to talk about the next 3 slides. They're all bar graphs. And really what they do is they sum up the bottom line here, which is as more and more employers have joined our trust fund, more cash flowed in, as you would expect. And then we took that cash and we've generated investment income. So the pension fund, a lot of people don't know this, but every dollar that's paid out to retirees, so my mother, she's a CalSTRS retiree, not a PERS, so they have a different ratio, but it's in the same ballpark. It represents about 65 pennies on the dollar that come from investment income, maybe 70 over the long term, but in the last year, it was 65. 35 pennies come from investment principal. They have mandatory 100% of our pre-funding, and they've been doing it for 80 plus years. We've been in business for 9 full years with voluntary contributions in the down economy for half the time with volatile investment markets, and we're generating 20 to 25 pennies on the dollar from investment income already. So it's really a testament, not to us, although it does speak to the effectiveness of the investment policy, but to the participating employers. Those 497 employers, through those tough times, put their money where their mouth is and have generated about 75% of the total pool of assets through investment principal contributions. So what's really impressive is the reliability, the degree of consistency that we can count on from their cash flows every year. And that benefits everybody that participates. So that's kind of the story of the trust fund. You know, I've been lucky to see it for most of the time, almost all the time, and it's been a really fun ride. And I hope that you'll join us, and I'm here for any questions that you have. So I'm going to wrap it up, and anything you want to know, I'll try my best.
Thank you so much.
You're welcome.
I have one question going back to slide number on page 3, slide number 6.
Sure.
Just to know off the top of your head, in terms of domestic versus international weighting of this, because I see the global equity, it's the whole world, but
correct,
how much of that is weighted
Yeah, it's either 52-48 in favor of international today or 51-49, but it would depend on the holding. So just recently, I obtained that information because I had a similar question from another customer. And I was actually kind of surprised because I can go back to a time it is high on the international side. I can go back to a time when it was more like 32-68 range, right, in favor of domestic equity.
Why is that changing?
You know, I'm not an employee in the investment office that's privy to all the decisions that they make, so I can opine, but I'm probably not very qualified to give you a meaningful answer. I don't know. It's a question that I want to answer to, but I'm not concerned about significantly because what these people in the investments office do are held accountable for are exceeding benchmark performance to their bonuses, and they are bonused. So I'm not, right? But they are. And they're significantly bonused, and they're bonused by exceeding their benchmarks. So they may believe that they can do that by investing in more international as opposed to domestic equity. But remember that the benchmarks are going to adjust on an ongoing basis, reoccurring, just like your valuation reports do for liability as opposed to reality, you know, assumptions as opposed to reality, I should say. And they're not going to make money consistently over the long term if they play a short-term strategic approach. So they're doing it for some reasons that are probably fine. It's just outside of the realm of what would be standard. I mean, a lot of people that live in the United States of America believe heavily in S&P 500 investments. Yeah. So it's a little bit different, I must admit. It's a good question. It's one that I can't answer, unfortunately. It's one of the few. At this point, I'm usually able to. But if you want me to talk to Brad Bachman and Christine Reese and the Affiliate Investments Program, I can give you that answer in writing.
I mean, I just, it struck me because it's unusual.
Yeah, we have a document that I brought with me that I'll leave with Eric, and he can give it to you. It's an asset class fact sheet. You can see the most recent quarter, so as of June 30, 2016, top holdings in the global equity asset class, and familiarize yourself with it a little bit more. And then if you have questions, just, you know, let me know.
Any other questions?
Expenses, 10 basis points on assets under management. I've also heard the comment that if you don't invest anything in a particular year, you won't be charged. What's the actual answer?
So that's a great question. I'm glad that you kind of poked a hole in the cheese there and made it Swiss, because depending upon the sequence of those statements, it could be hypocritical. Mm-hmm. So what I was saying is that we have employers who have joined the trust fund but have not yet sent us money, so they have not yet been charged a penny. Because we only charge you by subtracting the fee rate applied to assets under management on a daily basis. And until we have money in the account, we can't charge you because we're not technically doing our job. So the cost of all the administrative stuff up front, like me being here tonight, that's never incurred.
Right.
Yeah, the other 497 participating agencies are subsidizing my appearance this evening. So you would just simply be charged when and if you send us money. And at that point, it's very unlikely that you would zero out for a long time. So it's just a bridge of awkwardness we haven't had to cross yet.
Sure.
Yeah. So just putting that in the sequence, does that answer your question?
Yeah, I think so. I think basically what you're saying is if we put $10,000, say, just in an account year one, but we don't invest anything in year two, we're still going to be charged for the assets under management.
Absolutely. Yeah. And I can give you a hypothetical scenario that's so unlikely, but it's actually a perfect hypothetical scenario. If you put $1 million in the trust fund account on July 1 and it never changed day to day and stayed a million for 365 straight days, 10 basis points is $1,000. So it's $1,000 to manage $1 million.
Sure. Understood.
Yeah.
Okay. GASB 74 and 75. I've read enough to be afraid.
It's basically GASB 67 and 68 on OPIP.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah.
And so I've seen, and I think I'm probably misinterpreting some of what I see.
Okay.
But to me, it sounds like basically there's going to be increased financial disclosure. There's going to be balance sheet accounts that are going to have to be public as opposed to being in a footnote somewhere and buried. My concern is, and we have talked about OPEB being basically discretionary as opposed to, you know, locked in, where you have to pay that arc every single year.
Yeah.
Our arc would be very painful if it ever became actually required.
Right.
So when 74 and 75 go in, that arc is not mandatorily paid every year, correct?
No, you're correct.
Okay.
It is not mandatory. Mm-hmm. Currently, the federal government, the state of California, the governmental accounting standards board, the actual standards, and nobody requires that you fund a single penny of OPEB. And it's very different than pension. Mm-hmm. It's not a vested right. I mean, this is where it all starts. Look at the county of, I'm sorry, the city of Vallejo and the city of Stockton. Now, these were bankruptcy proceedings, but they both wiped out over $100 million in OPEB liabilities without any to-date litigation that's been successful against them, not even an attempt. I mean, it's pretty understood that these are not vested rights. You, the employer, reserve the right to adjust benefit levels moving forward and apply them to people if you wish to do so, and you face what you face. So it's tough to justify then putting a mandatory requirement on pre-funding a benefit. CalPERS is not actually in the position of being interested in doing that, because if you think about it, it would shoot them in the foot on the pension side. Mm-hmm. So actually, the pension contributions that you make are a competitor to my product.
Mm-hmm.
Okay?
Understood.
And so, and that's where they gain their notoriety, and that's their whole existence. We're just this little side piece. So I don't see CalPERS ever supporting something like that. They would maintain a position of neutrality publicly, and if they were to take a position, it would be to not be in favor of that. Mm-hmm. So I don't think that's likely. But what is going to be your reality is that the entire unfunded actual accrued liability for OPEB is going to hit the balance sheet. So now your total net position mm-hmm. on the balance sheet of your financial statements is impacted by that liability as opposed to a single 30th slice of it.
Correct.
So instead of dealing with one slice of the birthday cake, you're swallowing the whole birthday cake each year.
Yes.
So if you can get assets building up in an irrevocable account, and the key to irrevocability is that they now count to offset the liabilities, mm-hmm. and you can increase those assets while liabilities mm-hmm. continue to increase, you can not only keep pace with growth, but you can catch up with growth. Because the growth is going to be around 5%, and if you can grow high in terms of cost and liability increase, but if you can increase asset faster than that, then you can not only keep pace with it, but you can exceed pace mm-hmm. and catch up.
Understood.
So that's really the game. I mean, and right now for most investors, what they want to do is accumulate units of the trust fund, irregardless of their value. Dollar cost average their contributions, as opposed to sending 1.2 at one point in time, right. Send 100,000 a month if you can do it, and you decrease a little bit of market volatility with respect to that. The piece that you can control is a small chunk of it. So then over the long term, you start to worry more about your unit values. But for now, you're not. They're all unrealized losses anyway. From one year to the next, you have, you know, this many units, but it's the total dollar value, the market value of assets, that's offsetting liability. You right. still have huge liability and insignificant asset. But as you get closer to that, then you worry more about it.
Sure.
Yeah. So what I see a lot of employers do, and I think it's a mistake, but, you know, I'm not qualified to say that, you know, to them directly, but it's that they worry about fully funding their ARC, and if they can't do that, then why join? And what I've really learned from looking at the numbers is any amount is better than none, and sooner is better than later. If I were to listen to my dad and set up a 401k at 18, I'd be so much better off, but I spent it on stupid stuff.
Right.
So this is kind of the equivalent of that, but in a much more intelligent realm.
Understood.
Yeah. So I really do think, and looking at your numbers, I sent an email to Eric a long time ago when we were first kind of talking about this, it just makes so much sense for you. Your numbers are very common. This is going to be a good deal long term, mm-hmm. as long as you're committed for the long term to it.
Understood. So the term irrevocable scares a lot of people, and I just want to ask a couple of questions about that.
Yeah.
You had mentioned vested rights, and that's, I think, probably where I want to go, and that is okay. that there is the possibility of changing the benefit.
Right.
Okay, at some point in time, and that's something that, you know, certainly I've been thinking about a bit.
Yeah.
Once, let's just say we cut the deal from heaven with our employees
okay.
and we so drastically reduced that liability in the
yeah.
future that we didn't need the funds that we'd already committed to the irrevocable trust, we can get that money back, yes?
Yeah, but it doesn't work in increments.
Okay.
So this is a very good question. Mm-hmm. It's the question that's asked by the person that is thinking long term about the more significant piece of the solution, which is benefit levels.
Mm-hmm.
because I can help you arrive at a goal, but it's going to take a while unless you have a lot of money. Mm-hmm. And with respect to your budget and its relationship to liabilities, and most people don't. Okay, if you wanted to reduce your liability in half, you could do that through an agreement next year if you're capable of getting it done.
Right.
So what happens if your liability is $10 million and you have $5 million with us? And then all of a sudden, your liability becomes $2 million, and now you're overfunded by $3 million. Can you get your $3 million back? No. But it's not because we don't want to give it to you. It's because that's not allowable under governmental accounting standards. What is allowable is a full refund of all assets in the irrevocable trust fund account if you can demonstrate zero liability. So what you have to do is completely eliminate the liability. So what you have to do if you went from a liability of 10 to a liability of 2, and now you have assets of 5, and you're $3 million overfunded, okay, is you just have to stop sending us money and start reimbursing. What's the catch? Mm-hmm. The catch is that GASB only currently allows reimbursements to the tune of your annual retiree premium payments. So do you know your payroll cost ballpark that you pay?
$132,000.
So that's your liquidity maximum in a given year. Mm-hmm. So what am I proposing to every customer? Don't send more money than you're ever going to need in anticipation of future liability evolution.
Understood.
Yeah.
Okay.
Okay. It doesn't matter what the actuary currently values it at. It matters what your long-term goal is. But the important person in this process is the actuary. You got to go to them and say, this is how we want to structure our benefits moving forward. We're yet to come to that conclusion.
I'm sorry to interrupt. Yes. Is there anybody in the office?
Yeah.
Lady, sorry.
Okay. So basically what you want to do is figure out what your northbound goal truly is, not just what the actual accrued liability is as of the valuation date, and then just don't exceed that threshold.
Understood.
Now, in the meanwhile, you're going to pay a consequence for that is you're going to be underfunded, and the new accounting standards aren't doing you any favors.
Right.
So you'll book liabilities, but what you'll explain to your board, which is easier when it's you who has that vision, is that, but this is a long-term plan and we don't want to get overfunded because we don't want to throw more money into this than we'll ever need because that's an opportunity lost at funding some other.
Understood.
Yeah. So.
Okay. Yeah. That helps. Thank you.
Okay. You're welcome. Sometimes I take a while to get to.
No. That was a good explanation. Thank you.
Anyone else? All right. Well, I just wanted to thank again everybody for having me here, and Eric in particular, Director Shea, and anybody else who I've spoken to. I really appreciate your time.
Thank you.
And
thank you.
Good stuff.
Yeah,
thanks.
Bye. I'll talk to you soon.
Alright, we will move on to item G2, District Manager Report.
Did you comment on this?
Oh, sorry, comments from the public on that presentation?
Sure. We're not ready to put money in an irrevocable trust, not until we get our capital situation figured, sorted out. If I understood you correctly, Jeff, you said that Measure A is going to take care of our capital needs?
Not entirely, no.
Okay. So, I mean, if we look at the maintenance department, basically all the rolling stock needs replacement today. We need a new building. We also really need to upgrade our maintenance. I guess that's a management thing. To do this now is the equivalent of a guy with a lot of credit card debt, 18% or 21%, saying, I got to invest my money. First thing you do is you pay off the stuff that you need to pay off. And we need to get our house in order and then start looking to the future. I wasn't quite clear, I'm going to review the tape, what he said. If we overfund, it sounds like that's kind of where we can withdraw our principal, but whatever the excess earnings are, we don't earn. I didn't quite understand what he said.
Right.
We are losing an important tool because if we put it in this irrevocable trust, something we might not want to do at this point because of the situation with pensions being in flux. For example, the pension spiking right now is now being debated, I guess, in the state Supreme Court. That's going to affect what's going to happen with total pension liabilities. As a citizen, I see a situation where we're basically looking at a train wreck with our pension liabilities. We've got three employees here, and sorry, guys, and I don't know what Carolyn's situation is, but basically, these are million-dollar retirement pension liabilities that is going to have to come from someplace. And if we pre-commit our capital without having a good plan in place now, it's a good idea what we're doing. It's a very good idea what we're doing, but we're not ready for it just yet. We need to make sure that we've got the house in order first. And otherwise, what you're going to do is just put us in a situation where you're going to be forced to raise taxes, and I'm sure no one wants to do that, but it's going to be a never-ending cycle. So thank you for pushing this way, but let's do the entire job right now correctly.
Thank you for that. District manager's report.
Sure. Going through it, I have the bulleted items. I can bring it up to speed really quickly. I mean, the accounting system, everything I listed there is pretty set. We'll go over that after this. Solar is right, where we expected it to be. There is not an issue, I take that back. We are waiting. PG&E needs to perform some needed work on their lines on the outside of the building where it comes in. So we're waiting for them to do that. And then once that is done, we'll be installing the items I list there. We've completed the transformers, the interconnection, pulled the final power lines and the system interconnected. I've been having some communication with SOLED, just requesting about the finalization of details regarding the process of how payments will be moved from us to them, so working those pieces out. The CalPERS pension audit is something else we've been spending a lot of time. It's become a very frustrating experience for both Carolyn and myself, primarily because they haven't been very clear in moving towards resolution. They definitely acknowledge that we are trying to work with them the best we can to move towards resolution. Many of the delays have been on their side. And we've also sent them things to have them come back and say, oh no, what we really wanted was this. And so it's been a fun process, but they've been understanding of that, again, we are moving towards that direction. I still don't have a lot of feedback from them at all in terms of anything that's going to have any real financial impact, which is primarily the uniform allowance. Right now, I'm simply working with them on things like pay schedules for employees that will never, ever be enrolled in CalPERS due to the nature of the position, yet they seem to demand and feel that this information is required to them. So that's where we're at with that. The financial audit, we have been working with our auditor on, the GASB 68 reports that we got last year that we purchased from CalPERS were very specific to our agency. They are not doing those per agency anymore. They're just doing one giant report that shows the risk pool plans, which we did have to pay our share for them to do as well, which was obviously much lower, but we are a part of this risk pool and we're certainly listed in there. I have engaged a company called GovInvest to perform the actual GASB 68 reports that our auditor needs to be able to complete all the work he has to do for our balance sheet. I was in consultation with him. This was a company that was already on my radar and one of a handful that he sent me. Ideally, ultimately, they were the cheapest, and one of the reasons I wanted to go with them was they had the best turnaround time, and they give us access for a year at no charge to their proprietary software that allows us to do all sorts of modeling and things like that once we give them our data. So as that develops, I will let you know. I expect that work, at any rate, to be done by GovInvest within the next 2 to 3 weeks, and hopefully be in our auditor's hands so he can continue his work on an audit for that. And then the park maintenance shed, as I put in there, just have not been able to make a lot of progress this month, primarily due to other needs, time constraints, so on and so forth. But it is high on my list and something I think about every day and recognize it needs to be done.
Any questions, comments?
Yeah, I have a couple. Financial audit. We're not going to be paying CalPERS any longer for the actuarial report because they're no longer doing it at our level. Is that correct?
We are paying them for the risk pool level.
We're going to pay them for something that we're going to have crunched by somebody else.
Correct.
So we're going to get charged twice now.
For two slightly different things, yes. Yeah, they need, the other places need the information from CalPERS that they produce.
And is the charge going to be less?
Yes, it was.
Oh, that's nice.
Yeah.
Okay.
And if it makes you feel any better, Jeff, I had this very conversation with somebody from CalPERS when I asked these very questions, and I just said, so basically what you're telling me is that, I don't know what to tell you, but you have to pay it. And they said, yeah, kind of.
I saw a video clip of it. Yeah, okay. Got it. All right.
Yeah, very similar.
Yes. Okay. I think that's all.
Okay.
Any comments, questions from the public? All right, moving on to...
One comment about the solar structure. I wanted to say it looks great, everything turned out the best it possibly could. Hopefully it'll meet our needs, but one large concern I had was the size of that, and it looks like it was scaled back considerably. Is that true, Eric?
No.
It wasn't?
It was not scaled back. Okay. It's the dimensions it was always going to...
Okay, so it doesn't really take up much more room than the existing thing, and visually from the pool, it's not the huge mass that I thought it would be. So I guess I wanted to say I actually sent a note to Bill Hansel saying, you know, thanks for paying attention to the aesthetic considerations, and you know, hopefully we'll go forward and everything will work out there to the best to everybody's highest expectations.
I appreciate those comments. Thank you. I would definitely also recognize Danlin and the level of care that they put into listening to myself, listening to Shane. We got Luke involved and really kind of customizing the way it looks out there, exactly where it overhangs, how much water it hangs back over more towards the top pool area, produces a lot more shade there. Coming through, I mean, they listened to us down to, we don't want it this far to the right, or we don't want it, you know, and they did a lot of added touches to it as well in terms of installing some built-in lighting features for us and everything else. So thank you, Stephen. I appreciate that comment.
I also like to add, since I was there quite a bit during construction, well, maybe not during construction, but certainly during the period of construction, work site management was wonderful. Yeah. I mean, you know, that was a big concern, you know, with children, et cetera, et cetera. And then, you know, the pool participants, they did a great job managing the site.
I will pass it on, and we've shared that with them as well.
Thank you. So moving on to item J3, fiscal year 2016-17, quarter one budget actuals.
Sure. Before we move too much farther, I'm sorry.
And I am going to say that, like, we're getting close I'm just pointing out time-wise.
I can kind of stay on the agenda. I can do this quickly.
Okay.
I had emailed this already to you guys yesterday, just in terms of the summary that I told you I would. I do have extra copies here that I had printed specifically here for anybody who might show up. But they're just some summary notes based on, you know, just kind of some outrageous variances. Not outrageous, just outstanding variances that caught my attention or caught the Chief's or Carolyn's or Shane's attention that wanted to further explain. So you've had a chance, plenty of time to look at it all, and weekly is... comment in late, I'll just turn it back and see if there are any questions on it. I do. Thank you.
Great.
Even with the with a lump sum upfront on PERS, it does appear that we're probably going to, you know, as the run rates for the pension accumulated, looks like we're going to be a little bit over on those as well.
I'd have to look.
I'll send you my analysis, but it looks like if, you know, if we take the amounts that we're paying bi-monthly, sometimes three times monthly,
right,
and we accumulate those, we'll probably be a little bit over.
Okay.
Department by department, so. I understand most of this, though.
You said one more, though, Jeffrey.
No, that's okay. I'll let somebody else go for it.
I have three questions. On the park department, the park equipment, were you able to find out what it is? It just says needs further investigation.
Yes, and yeah, I did actually have answers for all of those things, and for the most part, on the that was a lot more than I could repair. It wasn't properly budgeted in there. That's why that went high.
And then the on the recreation, the pool maintenance. Shane, do you can you give us like an overview about the pool equipment? Will we need to get ready for another large purchase, or should we be okay for next year? What's the lifespan of the equipment that we have in place?
So historically, we've had one moderate to major failure a year with something that's not been planned. At this point, we've definitely spent a lot more time, energy, and money on the equipment in there for the last 2-3 years. So there's nothing big imminent. So barring anything breaking, we don't have anything big planned purchase-wise for the pool.
And can you please make sure that the Park and Rec Commission has the lifespan of each major investment piece in the schedule and the Measure A, whatever timeline schedule, just so
sure.
We can plan accordingly.
That's
the one, exactly. Yes. And then the land and building maintenance, non-anticipated maintenance on the recreation. Do you know what that was?
Which one is it?
It's
yeah.
310 on the recreation. The last three numbers are 310. Land and building maintenance.
I want to say that most of this came from the water heater.
Oh, okay. Yeah, we had a water heater that failed, that needed to be replaced, that leaked and killed itself. We had the same thing for 20 years. I think that's what you get out of the water heater.
Something like that.
Yeah.
Okay, thank you. That's all for me.
Any other questions?
Sure. In the fire department, overtime. Sorry to bring that up.
Sorry.
It's budgeted for 100 grand. That's for the whole year, right?
That's for the whole year.
And current July through September 16th, we're
$85,000. And that goes back to Joel being out.
Yeah.
You know, Otis leaving, being injured for an amount of time.
But conceptually, I'm looking at...
Oh, it's going to be over budget.
Okay. And then the MIRA operating, is that a one-time payment for MIRA? Okay,
yeah.
So that's
so we're
done
there.
Already. Okay.
I would say on the OT, and I don't know, I meant to ask the chief, actually.
We will be getting some of it has to do with Steve Heine's strike team assignment, and I anticipate about $25,000 coming back, which still puts us not in the ballpark.
Correct.
Yeah.
And I'm okay with you asking about it all the time. And I have a dream of one day having 10 fully staffed firefighters.
Okay.
It's going to happen.
I have a dream, too.
The other thing I would say, too, and I might have misheard what Bill said, is this is all the way through September 30th. The 16 there is just represents a year. It's not July through September 16th. So, yeah. It covers the entire book.
Any other questions?
No.
Questions from the public? Alrighty. Yay, thank you all for staying on track with our timing. Moving on to fire department matters. We have the minutes of the fire commission report. Are there any questions?
Any questions? It's a good meeting. Most of what we talked about will come before you as we move forward on fire department matters. I'm going to tell you, it's a pretty good commission right now. I do appreciate the work of a few of the members. Herb Schwartz, Greg Stilson, Dan Curran have been great additions. Whether or not I get to keep them all remains to be seen.
Any questions on the minutes? Into the captain's report? Oh, no, sorry. Fire activity summary and chief report.
And also, I just want to touch on, before we had the fire commission, we did do a walkthrough, which I wasn't sure what to expect, but was actually pretty helpful with a few things that Herb especially pointed out. You know, September, busy month again, training, testing, getting the probationary guys up to speed. You know, lots dealing with the overtime issues. Santa Fe's been helpful in shared services. That's about it. But Stephen.
Okay, I'm not sure if I'm on the right section. I noticed my neighbor was quite generous with a gift, which is great, and I'm just hoping that there is something public with acknowledgement of her generosity.
So I will go on to the chief's report, but I'll touch on that. Linda did make a very generous, Linda has made a couple of very generous donations, and I put a post on Nextdoor, and I also sent some verbiage to the Marin IJ, our Marin IJ contact, to see if we can get a brief story posted. I did not hear back. A letter to the editor has also been sent on Linda's behalf, thanking her for her donation. I've yet to see it published. But I think, for those of you who haven't heard, Linda made a donation of $2,500 for the department to buy a new gas meter. I put some information out on it on Nextdoor. Linda's relationship with the fire department goes back a number of years. So I probably should have included in here after, but I posted on Nextdoor, and I moved on to 14 other things. But she's been very gracious going back 6 or 7 years. We have some great rope rescue equipment, which we use weekly, if not more often, which has been extremely helpful. And this gas meter is another tool that we'll continue to use, you know, if not daily, at least weekly. So it's been very kind of her, as well as what we see is a nice ice cream drop off about once a month. So, you know, thank you, Linda, for that stuff. And then, we do appreciate it. You got a few props on Nextdoor, which I thought was nice. So, thank you.
Well, I just want to make one other remark. It's not only important just to give her a good pat on the back, but also it may inspire other people to be generous and donate. And so I certainly appreciate it. Thanks.
The SCBAs have been ordered. The money's been requested. Hopefully that'll all be reconciled within the next month. Community service grants kind of been put on, or the trailer's kind of been put on hold because I've been really busy doing some other things, but my goal by the end of this calendar year to have that up and running. That's it.
Okay. Any questions for the chief? Any additional comments from the public? Now we are at item H3, public hearing adopting and modifying the California Fire Code, International Fire Code, and Appendix A of the International Wildland Urban Interface Code. So in conducting a hearing, somebody must remind me what I...
We basically, as a public hearing, this is the opportunity for the public to speak, to address, to... basically that, speak, address, or make comment on what the code is. The chief obviously is here as the expert in this category that can address any specific questions, so on and so forth.
All right, so this can open up the public hearing.
I'll just start by saying this is kind of a point of business that the district goes through every 3 years. Interestingly enough, up until my start as the fire chief, the district never adopted the fire code or the wildland urban interface code, and the district operated under the assumption that we fall under unincorporated Marin County, so whatever
code that county adopts, we will, you know, just be all under abuse. But they have a new fire marshal about 10 years ago who requested that we start doing this process, and we have, and it's been helpful, and it's actually come into play a couple of times where I'm glad we have had to use it for a few insurance instances. But it's basically every 3 years the code is updated, and they have local jurisdictions go through the process of adopting it. Fire prevention officers in Marin County go through, they take the 2016 code and they analyze it, review it, make some modifications to it that are particular to Marin County. That's what's before you tonight. And then when it comes down to Marin County, each individual agency may make a few additional modifications for their own jurisdiction. Santa Fe, for instance, has a very aggressive vegetation management part where they require people in the urban interface to remove bamboo or juniper, or they could be heavily fined. I toyed with the idea of adopting the Santa Fe code this year, but fell back to, I think it's a little too aggressive, and the fact that we're still Marinwood, unincorporated Marin, we're adopting the same code as the county, which is also helpful because I work real closely with Scott Albert, the county fire marshal, on code-related issues, so.
Thank you. Any questions from the board, public?
On the vegetation control, the remover of bamboo and juniper.
Yes.
But we don't do that.
We don't require them to do that. When I do inspections or home inspections or vegetation management inspections of private residences, I encourage them to remove that. But it's not something that we enforce or require them to do. Santa Fe, so if you live in the wildland urban interface zone, there's areas of Mount Marin that do. A couple of years ago, they went through there, told people on one side of the street, you have to remove all the junipers on your property, or you're going to start being fined $150 a day until it's done. So
it's a great way to make some money.
You know, it's a good way to make some money. It seems a little Machiavellian to me. I'm still at the personal belief that your home is your castle. If you want to surround it with oil-laden plants that are going to burst into flames, so be it. I actually have some juniper in my front yard. That's a different story. I didn't want to go that route. I still like to think of the fire department as the good guys. So, but that is an option as you move forward in the next code adoption. I didn't take us there this time.
Okay. Were there any specific Marinwood changes? No. It was all from county?
It's all from county.
It is, yeah. Okay. Is there anything in particular that the county adopted that you find you're uncomfortable with?
There's nothing I'm uncomfortable with. I can tell you is that of that code, a lot of it is just not applicable to us. I mean, they talk about, you know, underground storage, propane storage tanks, or,
right.
You know, spray booth garages and things like that. It's just in the code. But it's not applicable to us. So really this deals with new construction or substantial remodel, of which we deal with, it's almost entirely residential.
Understood. Okay. Have you ever been put in a position where you've had to arrest anybody?
No.
Ah, that's good.
Nor will I ever arrest anybody. If it comes to that, I work with the sheriff's department.
Yeah, yeah. I mean, the language is
But it could be, it's pretty aggressive. It gives me the power of arrest, but it's not something I would ever do.
Sure.
I am PCA 32 trained from just one of the things I've done over the years. Mm-hmm. So I'm aware of, you know, search and seizure and arrest laws. But no, really, that comes down to more really bad code violations, mm-hmm. but or fire investigation, arson and fire investigation.
Right.
That's the biggest one.
Okay. Very good.
Are you ready for our resolution reading and approval?
Okay. I think close the public hearing unless there's other comments, and then we'll do the resolution.
All right, let's close the public hearing and then we will do the adoption. And I just read the as right. All right, so this is for resolution 2016-08, adopting and modifying the California Fire Code, International Fire Code, and Appendix A of the International Wildland Urban Interface Code. Do I have a motion?
I move to approve.
Okay. Any discussion? Any discussion from the public or any comments from questions from the public?
Yeah. It seems very aggressive. I'm surprised that we have to add stuff to the standard code to be more safe, but you've explained that this is the county's doing, and we're just following the county, is that correct?
Correct. And this, really, there's subject matter experts in the Marin County Fire Prevention Officers, guys like Scott Albert, Bill Tyler, Jessica Powers from Tiburon. They have spent, I mean, hours and hours and hours and hours of work and research dissecting this code and making it applicable to Marin County as a whole, and then if they want to make further changes to it to a local agency. So I know a lot about the code, but really, when it comes to this stuff, I pick up the phone, I call Scott Albert, Bill Tyler, and I say, what do you think? And then I listen to them.
Yeah, I mean, a lot of this is actually, I would think, fall under planning, the prohibition of vehicle parking on private access ways, stuff like that. An umbrella being something that you would do. I'm just really actually surprised at how exhausted this document is. That's all, it was just really a comment, so.
Thank you. Can I call the question? All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Now we're at item H5, authorized sale of reserve type 1 engine to Long Valley Volunteer Fire Department for $18,000 payable over two equal installments.
Move to approve.
Second.
All right, any discussion?
I like the fact that instead of three installments, it's down to two.
Yeah.
Agreed.
These guys are super fired up to get this engine.
This is great, and it's been the only offer.
This has been the only offer, and
taking up the terms just makes it all that much easier.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
Any questions, comments from the public?
Do we have Owen and money on that?
No.
I think it's wonderful that we're getting some salvage value out of it, and congratulations on getting that deal done.
Yeah, thank you. Caesar was very helpful.
I was about to say, commend Caesar for his efforts in getting it listed in all the places and seen and so on.
Excellent. All right, so I'll call the question. All those in favor?
Aye.
All righty. Date of the next fire commission meeting, December 6th.
Yeah, we're going to skip November.
Yeah, okay. Wow, seems really far away. All right.
Be here before you know.
Okay. Item I, Park and Rec Matters. Minutes of the draft minutes of the Park and Rec Commission meeting, September 27th.
We did our tour, our last tour of the season. We toured the community center building. There wasn't a whole lot of comments on that specific tour, other than the kitchen, which we're still working on getting remodeled. So we're hoping to have that scheduled sometime this winter. And a lot of it has to do with how often we're booked with the rental, so we need, you know, 3-4 week window. So that was the main comments on the tour. And the only other item of note is the commissioners are working on some plantings in a few different areas, or ideas for plantings by the tennis courts and also along the walkway leading to the Merlin playground.
I walked by it the other day and God, it's so much cleaner.
Yeah.
It used to be. It looks great.
Yeah, things are getting cleaned up.
Question on our ozone.
Still waiting. Our last update was a few weeks ago that they wanted such comprehensive design of our pump room that Gary, the person that was in charge of it, hadn't had the 2 weeks that it was going to take to get it done. So supposedly he's working on it as we speak. I'll have an update at the next meeting. I told him if it doesn't happen soon, then the check's going back to the bank.
Yeah. Just in time to close the pool.
Yeah.
I would say, and Shane, please correct me if I'm wrong, it's been the county that's been holding this up in the permitting.
Yeah, he was, everyone's been kind of taken aback by how much information they want to put this in. And I guess there's not really any, there's hot tubs with it, but not a whole lot of public pools in Marin with it, or with this type of design. So I guess that's what's holding it up.
All right, any other questions on the draft minutes? Okay, move on to the recreation activities. Activity reports?
Yeah, so the main thing in the report is all of our summer financials are in here, both summer camps and pool aquatics. So is there any questions on that? We had a great season. Pool was pretty much right where it was at last year, which last year was our best season at the pool. We would have done a little bit better, but we had a lot of maintenance, as you can see, maintenance on pool equipment. If you were to take some of that out, we would have ended the season better than last year. So I'm pretty happy with the way we ended things. Some of the highlights on there, put some notes, but the chlorine generators that we purchased definitely saved us quite a bit in chemical usage. So that we were extremely happy with. And not to mention, it saved us a lot of time with park staff not having to drive to pick up, you know, 200-pound carboys of chlorine weekly. And same thing with CO2 tanks. So overall, I'm happy with the pool. Is there any questions specifically on the pool and aquatics?
I just have a comment on the verbiage on the report. They use the net revenue, and I hope you mean net income or profit or surplus?
Yes, net profit.
Okay,
yeah,
because net revenue would be revenue less any potential discounts that you would be offering.
Yeah, I'm using it in terms of revenue minus any expenses. So gross revenue minus
that's
expenditures.
Profit or surplus,
yeah.
Okay.
So profit, yes.
So I would recommend adjusting to be clarified, to be clear going forward.
Any other questions on the pool? Steven?
No, I just have a couple of comments. First of all, I learned how expensive that slide is to operate this year. And maybe we should think in terms of getting rid of it and replacing it with a diving board. As
we with Steven on some.
As you, you're welcome. We're going to bring up plenty of things. But to have three staff manning a single slide, that really adds up, even with low-paid part-time staff. And so I really do think that that's something you might want to take a look at. The second thing is, I'd like to see discriminatory pricing. In other words, the people who are a part of the Marinwood CSD should not have to pay. They pay a slight less than the general public, and with the discounting that's going on, actually the public actually pays a lot less if they take advantage of these Groupons. We've got a group that comes here for lunch, fills up all the lanes. I'm a swimmer, that's when I swim. We earn more than $5 that we get from all those people. But we need to pay attention to the quality of service. Shane and his staff do an enormous job, a fantastic job, and I just think there's an opportunity here for additional revenue which would not detract from the experience that we have here in the park. I guess that's for next year's budget, but I'd like to see it. If you look at some of the other communities, Sleepy Hollow, they have a Sleepy Hollow membership, and then the general public pays almost double what the Sleepy Hollow members pay to access that pool. I'm not suggesting we do that much, but we really should be paying attention to how much revenue that we bring in. We provide a good experience. There's no sense we have to, you know, give away our services here, and it certainly shouldn't cost the public here more than the public from the surrounding communities to access. Thanks.
All right, thank you. Continuing on with the activity report.
Sure. So camps real quickly. Camps did extremely well. Again, last year was the best year we ever had in camps, and I wasn't expecting us to be too much ahead of last year.
net, but we ended up with quite a bit of a profit. Robin really crushed it this year. So as you can see, total, the profit was just over $400,000, and it's probably going to be a couple thousand more than that, certainly accounted for all the pool revenue from the last week. So I'm extremely happy with the way we ended the season. Any questions on camp? Let's touch on a couple things. We had our art and wine show this last Saturday. It was the best one so far. It was, attendance was great. Everyone really enjoyed themselves. We made some money off some art that was sold. So, and I think I've got at least 3 or 4 emails from people in the public here in the neighborhood that really enjoyed the event. So kudos to Susan Press for putting on a great event. This Friday is our Halloween Harvest Festival. It's supposed to rain. We'll figure it out, but that's one of our events where it's really crowded. So we're trying not to advertise it too much other than to just the residents here, so we'll see how it goes.
So we shouldn't come?
You should come, but don't tell your friends.
Okay, just
we emailed
her. She was asking. She was like, well, they can't have a bounce house if it rains.
Yeah, we're probably not going to have a bounce house if it rains, so we're going to have to...
But she was happy about it. She's like, I don't like bounce houses anyway. But well, like,
yeah, we're going to move some things around. We had Marin Mommies take it off their website, or we asked them to, just because we don't want a lot of outside people coming if we don't have the space for them. So, but we're looking forward to it just the same. Hope it doesn't rain too hard. Park maintenance. Guys are just still at it. As you can see, the turf area on the far field is still fenced off. This Friday, we're going to be removing about half that fence. So all the people with dogs will be happy. They've been kind of infiltrating the field over here. In addition, we're going to be walking the creek next week. And I've listed everything that we've worked on over the past month and what's coming up.
Walking the creek from where to where?
From Lucas Valley Road to Casa Marinwood.
You don't check estates?
Yeah, we don't walk the creek there. You can't really walk the creek there.
It's wide open up there, too.
Okay. Yeah.
Okay. Any other questions?
Yeah.
Any other questions or comments from the public? All right, the next date of the next Park and Rec meeting is October 25th. And now we're on item J, new and other business. And the only thing I see on there is requests for future meeting agenda items. Starting with the board, any requests? Is that it?
Pass,
okay.
Nothing.
Okay. Anything from the public? I was going to say, I would give you the giant thing.
I have one thing.
Yes.
You know, I requested this earlier in the year. It was not well received, but I believe the way that we manage our, not our parks area here, but the open space and God and other open space areas is really, to me, substandard. If you look back in that one section, I mean, it basically looks like a construction site. And it doesn't have to look that way. We've got good staff. But there is a lack of a plan for care. We're back to piles of wood chips as our landscaping. And I think it's unfortunate. We've got 3 hardworking guys who are paid a good salary, and I know they want to do good work, and they just simply need the instructions. So I would request that you look at this seriously and ask yourself, what can we do to make this entire room at CSD a nicer place, not just take care of it, but make it nicer. Thanks.
Thank you for that. Any other comments, questions about new and our request for future meeting agenda items? Okay. Right, hearing none. We're on item K, recognitions and board member items of interest.
I would like to ask you, as a representative of the board, to write a thank you letter to Linda for the donation. And I'd like to...
Here a lot. Weekends, Carolyn included too, she falls into that heading. She's been down here the last three Saturdays volunteering her time to help with these events, so.
But that's just for the beer and the wine.
It could be, you could be right.
No, I think it's actually for the overtime.
Oh, yeah, that's right.
You'll have to bring that up. Any other board member recognitions or items of interest? Okay. Oh my gosh, we're here, you guys. We're at item L.
Oh.
Can I have a motion?
Motion to adjourn.
Second.
Any discussion? Any comments from the public? All right, let's call the question.
Go for it.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.